sort of way of thinking or sort of explanation like that, explanation or I think it's, sometimes I think the gospel or sentence or some story, the Christian, they usually say, explain usually, I'm something like third person, this is some different sort of kasoda views, and then explain. So I think 2-3 days, it is quite sort of difficult sort of, or say the task, explaining, or try to convince there is creator, there is God. I myself personally don't believe that. So sincerely, you see, they invited me with some kind of, sort of expectation, it's my duty to fulfill. You see, there are sort of because of that, there are expectation. So in Buddhist text, you see, some ancient sort of Indian tradition, you see, who have the sort of concept of creator. So they have certain sort of reasons, use. So some extent I know these things. So I use these reasons, existence of creator. then of course you see, the similar practice, you see, practice of forgiveness, these things. One sort of gospel used to say, Jesus Christ, you see, there are one person hit here and show this, not good. So these are, you see, the similar sort of practice, and then also, you see, they give alms away, helping. Oh. Same. Sometimes Christian brothers and sisters are more active than Buddhist monks and nuns, like that. I noticed it in anyway, not too much. So therefore, so the later their group came to India, and Bodh Gaya, some sort of seminar near Bodh Gaya temple, Buddhist stupa. So then they want each morning, I think at least 2-3 days, each morning they want to carry silent meditation under Bodhi tree. Christian brothers, sisters, and some Buddhists. And then later, and then some Hindus, then later one Muslim also. He said, we sit together under Bodhi tree, where historically is Buddha got enlightenment. So we sat together, had about 30 minutes silent meditation. Those Christian brothers and sisters, they every day, you see, every day or today, very often, you see, meditate, silent meditation. So they can use that practice. Some Buddhists, when we join there, when 30 minutes of silent meditation, some coughing, like that. You see, Christian brothers and sisters, they completely, you see, they've been silent. Like that. So these things are really a wonderful sort of method to actually experiencing some sort of common value. Wonderful. So since 1975, I start one practice group, because the group people from different faith go to different kind of the religious sites. That I start Sarnath, Varanasi. First, I went to small mosque and some prayer, silent meditation. Then Hindu temple, then church, then one Buddhist monastery. Then some Gurdwara. At the Gurdwara afternoon, last. So we also feel a little hungry. So Gurdwara, we usually say, kind of provide you some kind of meals. Prashad, no. We call. I think some Indian here. Yes. No. Oh, prashad.
Some blessings.
Oh, very delicious. Every Gurdwara, you see, usually you see, give you that prashad. So not only blessing, but also very practical help too when you feel hungry like that. So since then, whenever I have opportunity, I always do that. And with that spirit, in France, Lohut. And yesterday I mentioned Fatima. And then also Jerusalem. Oh, wonderful. The seed of major, I think, at least I think 2-3 so traditions from there. So firstly, Wailing Wall. Silent meditation. And then one church within the Kasota. Phaganganate.
No. Within the church.
Like that. Then some Muslim, mosque, like that. So these things. And then, of course, like Assisi, the former late Pope, the Polish. John Paul. John Paul. Oh, wonderful person. Wonderful spiritual leader. So in any way, so these are, I think we, everybody, now have responsibility, you see, to make clear all these major traditions. All carry same message, same practice, use different method, different philosophical views. All have same potential. So the unity is not only necessary, but very, very possible. So that's very important. Now, about Buddhism. A particular text, Heart Sutra. So, in Buddhist, I think morning session about a philosophical thing, and afternoon session about altruism. That's common with every sort of religious tradition. The morning session about the philosophical thing, that's something different and something unique. Oh, now. Within Buddhism, the Pali tradition and Sanskrit tradition. Originally, I think Buddha taught a local language. They gradually combined. Then the Pali language use. So main language. So Pali tradition. Our last 2,500 years, the Pali tradition remained very, very sort of intact. In Burma, Thailand, Cambodia, Sri Lanka, very wonderful. a few corrupted monks there also, I think. In Sanskrit tradition, also is it there, among Tibetan, among Chinese, among Vietnamese, Korean. You see some corrupted people, of course, you see, I mean, understandable. But overall, wonderful sort of tradition. And one of my Indian friend, Guingaji, you see, he practiced, he carried teaching the practice of Vipassana. Near Bombay, he established one sort of center. You see, his sort of lineage come from Burma. Wonderful, wonderful. then Sanskrit tradition. I think in India, after Buddha, then eventually, which century I don't know. I think most probably first Takshashila in Pakistan, now in Pakistan. Then about, I think, since, I think, second century, first century, the Nalanda institution developed. That become, I think, the main center, or main learning center, Buddhism. Also the Pali tradition as well as the Sanskrit tradition, both. And then those masters from Nalanda learning center, monastic institution, those scholars mainly writing in Sanskrit language, like that. Like Nagarjuna and Aryadeva, all these top scholar, top thinker, really, their mind very, very sharp, very sharp. And Digna, great logician, great epistemology, like that. So they wrote mainly in Sanskrit. So then I think second or third century, from Nalanda, I think Tangsen, sort of, Tangsen, the Chinese, a wonderful sort of,
master.
You see, he came to India, and I think joined Nalanda institution, study, then he brought Buddhism. I think, in any way, he was one of the main sort of the person who brought Buddha, Nalanda tradition in China. I think around the second century or third century. No.
Before.
Then another one, I think. China, Buddhism, I think, reached third century. Isn't it?
Second, third.
That's right. Then Vietnam, or Korea, Japan, some, I think, directly from India. But main tradition through China, isn't it? When Buddhism reached Vietnam, which century?
Second century.
So more or less the same time. Then later, Tibet. That's about 7th century. One sort of significance was the 8th century, 7th century, you see, the idea or interest about Buddhism, you see, much developed. I think through a marriage, one princess of Chinese emperor. So she, and also one princess of Nepalese king. So both, you see, brought one Buddha statue. Each one brought Buddha statue. That, you see, since then, you see, kept in Lhasa main cathedral. So this, I think, brings interest about Buddha Dharma. However, Then I think 8th century, the Tibetan emperor, now he sent invitation to Nalanda institution. Then one of the top master in 8th century in Nalanda, Shandarakshita, judging his writing, Madhyamika philosophy, and also logic, Buddhist epistemology. Oh, really? When we read, you see his writing, oh, then you see we can, so that we can see this his mind, such a brilliant, great thinker, great sort of, because of the logician, right? Like that. So previously, Dignak, Dharmakirti, these are almost like, I think, pillar of Buddhist logician. This Chandrakshita, then you see, take all the essence of these sort of previous sort of Kasata writings, like that. So since the real introducer, Buddha Dharma, in Tibet, he himself, one of the top master of Nalanda institution. So a Tibetan Buddhist tradition, a direct link with Nalanda, not through translator, but one master directly to the master. And some historians say that when he reached Lhasa, his age, around 75 or something like that. So quite old. But then, you see, he started sort of teaching. Originally, I think, through translation. Then he himself, you see, tried to learn Tibetan. I can imagine, you see, his pronunciation of Tibetan, I think something difficult. I think must be something very difficult. And then one old Indian master, so I think difficult. However, you see, he give encouragement Tibetan Kasuda must use their own language. So, you see, the translation started. So since then, over 300 volumes translation. Each volume about page 400.
Folios.
Yeah.
400, around 400 folios.
Oh. You should even 800.
No. Oh. So if you count both the sides of each folio, then it would be around 800 pages.
So such sort of volume, the Buddha's own word, about 100 volumes. Then commentary, about 225 volumes, all translated from India, mainly Sanskrit, and also Pali, and also some Nepalese Kasoda script, like that. So I usually describe Tibetan Buddhist tradition is a pure lineage of Nalanda tradition. And then, as I mentioned earlier, the Chandrakshita and also his disciple, one top disciple, Kamalashila, I think around 9th century, you see, he also, invited by Tibetan, then I think the Tibetan emperor. So therefore, both great logician. So in Tibetan Buddhist study, we use logic intensely, right? So it is quite I think whereas in Chinese tradition, I think not much sort of use these logics. The Buddhist, Tibetan, I think tradition. I think because of these two masters, they themselves, you see, great Khosla, a master of Khosla
logic,
logic like that, epistemology like that. So now Chinese translation, the Buddha's own word, I think, you see, some translation in Chinese not available in Tibetan. So since few years, now we already start, mainly in Taiwan. You see, those texts which not available in Tibetan, they translate into Tibetan. And those texts not available in Chinese, available in Tibetan, then translate into Chinese. So this, I think then Pali also, I think the one Sanat institution, we already start the Pali class or study. So now, not like ancient time, now we have very easy to communicate. So therefore, we must take this Khasota opportunity to see the Khasota.
So we need to share this knowledge where some texts are lacking in one language, we should take them from.
So then, you should not confuse in Tibetan Buddhist, you see, some say we are a yellow head sect, we are red head sect, we are black head sect, and also is a white head sect. That's a pen. The original tradition is pen. They usually pen shakar shamgabo.
No, so the indigenous Tibetan religion called pen. They call it the sect
within,
with white head.
Within each sort of different sort of tradition, subsects. For example, Gyu sect. There are.
Four major and eight minor sub-schools.
Sometime in Europe, in I think 2000, perhaps I think 2008, 70s and 80s, then you see quite a strong sectarian. I was told this is some one Gyu sect center never invite same Gyuba from other sort of the
order.
Other order. As well as the yellow insect. And then there's some demonstrator outside. They are very much sort of, I see the yellow head sect follower. They believe, you see, the person who practice, who are follower of a yellow head sect should not even touch the text from red head sect. So since I pursue non-sectarian sort of, what's the day, Khasota way, many past Tibetan masters, actually, the non-sectarian sort of, what's the day, Khasota.
Are non-sectarian. Are not non-sectarian.
They follow, it's a non-sectarian sort of. So therefore, and then of course, other reasons also there. I myself, actually, they follow or worship that spirit. The other day, it's Sydney I mentioned, out of my ignorance. Then eventually, you see, I noticed fifth Dalai Lama used to consider this is evil spirit, very harmful. Then historically, also you see, if you judge that those people who seriously sort of worship that, some kind of problems often used to happen. Some monastery also. One monastery in the past not worshipped that spirit. Then I think last I think 60, 70 years, you see some, you see they also that start worship that. Then eventually, Nalol Machama, Tengzi Mazang.
And so the people, the monastics living within that community, monastic community, became very, there was lots of conflict amongst themselves. unfriendly.
So then eventually, I think early 70, then I noticed this is something wrong. So then I completely sort of stopped that sort of worship. But meantime, right from the beginning, they said, individual person, whether should accept religion or not, up to individual. So nobody can impose. So individual who worship that spirit or not, also up to individual, but must know the whole background. It is my duty make clear from my own sort of mistake and sort of these sort of the fuller knowledge about the reality. It is my duty make clear, whether listen or not, up to individual, like that. So I think the mistake we Tibetan, you see, too much emphasis, importance of branches. The one day I was in one Gurkhi monastery there in India. I told them, the yellow headset, red headset, these are like finger. Without palm, one finger cannot work. So Nalanda tradition, these about 300 volumes, these are the like basic sort of arm. Then our sort of Tibetan lamas, you see, they are writing. Support, you see, because of that, they mean supplement, you see, these basic teaching. Mistake is forget the basic teaching, and then too much emphasis these branches. So I often is telling Tibetan, now we must go to original sort of concept, original tradition. That's very, 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 very important. And anyway, sometimes, unfortunately, the Lama politics or religious politics also sometimes happen. I think among Christian also maybe so. Everywhere. I think about the Vietnamese Buddhists also some politics sometimes, maybe. I say everywhere. I think due to our weakness like that. So this is my style is make clear all the faults, all the mistake. This is important. If we remain, oh, everything, something nice, 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 good, 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 then there is real danger, rotten, right? From within. Buddha stated, nature is, chilo ne meb sotu maris, sengi kona, kogwa na bujim shiva na jishine, nalo ne gyan yung res, disungduwa.
And so the Buddha has said that my teaching, Buddhism, my teaching will not be destroyed from some external forces, by someone outside of the religion, the tradition, but it will be actually destroyed from within, like a lion being eaten by bugs from within its body.